Campaign 2020 is sponsored by Wisconsin Hospital Association, Quick Trip, Wisconsin Counties Association, Wisconsin Realtors Association, and Wisconsin Operating Engineers Local 139.
Kelda Roys of Madison is a former Democratic state representative running in the primary for the 26th state Senate. The primary is August 11th. Kelda, welcome back to WisconsinEye.
Good to be with you, Steve.
Well, very interesting times as of late in terms of the national and statewide debate over police reforms. Now, I've been to your website. You've got a pretty aggressive list of things you of changes you'd like to see made. One of them is you want to go back to residency requirements for police. So talk about that and other reforms that you want to see in terms of changes to how our police officers conduct themselves.
Well, I think it's clear that we have a crisis in this country and in Wisconsin with racial disparities. And one piece of that is the criminal justice system and how we incarcerate a higher proportion of our African-American residents than any other state in the nation. That's totally unacceptable. And it starts, of course, with policing and how law enforcement resources are deployed. Now, I think there are a lot of things that we can do to reduce police brutality. Some of the most important are instituting community control over law enforcement. We need to make it clear that law enforcement is here to serve us, the community, and not the other way around. And making sure that we have stringent use of force guidelines. For instance, there should really never be a situation where you have to do a chokehold or a stranglehold on someone. We need to make sure police officers are held accountable when they themselves are guilty of misconduct, and that we can track officers who have a pattern of abusive behavior towards individuals so that they don't get rehired. But we also need to hold police officers who are bystanders accountable, because it's very difficult to change the culture in law enforcement without getting larger groups of people on board and making sure that the officers who stood by as George Floyd was murdered minute after minute are held accountable for their misconduct as well.
Why do you want to go back to the residency standard, Kelda?
Well, I just want local control here. I think that municipalities should be able to decide whether or not they want to have certain residency requirements. I think that particularly when you have communities like Milwaukee that are highly segregated, and Madison is as well, there can be a dynamic where you have predominantly white officers living outside of the communities that they are policing. And you know, going into areas that are predominantly Black, into which the officers might not have a meaningful connection, and ultimately that leads to a lack of trust on both sides, and a sense that you know the police are really there to invade or harass rather than members of the community that are part of the public safety network that neighborhoods need.
Okay, understand. From your website, I think we can go through some of your positions pretty quickly. Your website says you're in favor of both medical and recreational marijuana, correct?
Yeah, I don't see any reason that we need to be the only state in our surrounding area that it continues to criminalize cannabis use. It's just a terrible use of resources. And you know, more broadly, substance use disorder should not be dealt with as a criminal justice matter, but rather as a public health and a healthcare matter. It's just, you know, an insane way to make the racial disparities worse in this state and to deprive people of the care that they actually need to get better.
And on the issue of reapportionment, do you favor Governor Evers' plan for a people's commission that would draw maps and then forward it to the Senate and the Assembly and the governor to be enacted?
Absolutely. I'm a longtime supporter of independent, nonpartisan redistricting because I think voters should get to choose their representatives and not the other way around.
Okay. Well, as a veteran member of the Assembly, you can understand the implications when Governor Evers says that because of the pandemic, GPR tax collections may fall $2 billion in the fiscal year that started yesterday. Okay, that would mean tough decisions. Cut some major spending programs to make up that $2 billion, or raise revenues, which would mean raise taxes or fees. Where are you on that potential debate?
Well, I think we are going to have some very tough choices to make, and that's why it's important to have experienced leadership in the legislature. The first thing I think we need to do is make sure that we're capturing all of the federal revenue that we possibly can. That means, for instance, taking the Medicare expansion. It's unconscionable in a pandemic that people are still without health care and health insurance, and taking that federal Medicaid money is essential, not just for Wisconsinites to have coverage, but to help support our healthcare providers and provide new healthcare jobs. So taking federal money wherever we can get it is job number one. Number two, I think we do need to start asking the wealthiest and luckiest among our state, big corporations that have been getting a free ride for, you know, quite some time, to start paying their fair share. Right now, the tax burden is falling disproportionately on working people and on small businesses. And as a small business owner, you know, it's very frustrating to see programs that were created to sort of help small businesses being totally taken over and the resources funneled to big corporations. So it's really time to have more tax fairness in Wisconsin. Third, I do think that there are some areas where we can cut spending and be really smart. I think that we should not be spending more on mass incarceration and our prison system than we do on the University of Wisconsin, which is the engine of our economy. That is shameful. You know, we, as I have traveled around the state as a state representative and a candidate for governor and an advocate, you know, one thing I hear again and again is that people want a smart public safety system. They don't want to continue spending money on an ineffective criminal justice system that we know disproportionately harms communities of color.
Who could be let out of prisons without threatening public safety, Kelda?
Well, a good chunk of the people who are there actually have already served their time for whatever underlying violation they may have committed. But what they're there for is a non-criminal parole revocation. So it's a crimeless revocation. Maybe they didn't get home from work in time to meet a curfew that was arbitrarily imposed. Maybe they missed a call or a meeting with a parole officer. Those kinds of things. Or maybe they went to somebody's house and there was wine there and they're not supposed to be around alcohol. So these kinds of things really should not be sufficient to pull people who are reintegrating out of the community, take them away from their jobs and their families, and put them back in prison at a cost of tens of thousands of dollars per year to our taxpayers. That's crazy. It harms public safety, and it's filling our too crowded prisons.
Okay, two questions on COVID. As you're aware, it hits the economy and puts great stress on some of the providers that state government relies on. It caused less revenue, but more demands for safety net programs like Medicaid. If you're back on the ledge in the Senate voting on the next budget, should the next budget place a higher priority on Wisconsin hospitals?
Well, healthcare providers in general. I mean, hospitals are one, but there are a lot of community healthcare centers, federally qualified health centers. There are a lot of healthcare providers that are struggling right now. And, you know, we know that healthcare providers are also being asked to contribute through furloughs and taking pay cuts during a pandemic, and that just seems totally counterintuitive. I think that our budget needs to prioritize delivering as much comprehensive healthcare in an affordable or zero cost way to as many people as possible. And so that's what I'm going to be advocating for in the budget.
Okay. As an attorney, here, this question: if a business follows all that the WEDC or the CDC guidelines on health and safety, should they be immune? Should they be immune from frivolous lawsuits?
Well, that's kind of a loaded question. I mean, I do think if we want to reopen the economy, we have to have clear guidelines and predictability for businesses. As a business owner, you know, it is hard to know exactly what the right thing to do is when there's conflicting information. And that's why I think it's very important to have clear standards, something that, you know, the Wisconsin Republicans in the legislature have fought against and sued to get rid of. If we want to allow the economy to reopen, we need to tell businesses exactly what they need to do to be safe. And we also need to tackle the crisis of childcare and schools. It's astonishing to me that in a legislature, a state senate with 33 members, there's not a single woman who has young kids at home. And totally absent from the national discussion is how we're going to go back to work when women are still bearing a hugely disproportionate share of the work at home, whether it's homeschooling or childcare, in the face of daycares being closed. So that to me is the biggest question.
Okay. The property tax debate, which you've dealt with as a former member of the assembly, to control property taxes, school districts, local governments deal with revenue caps and limits on what they can levy in property taxes. Of course, if they pass a referendum, they can exceed those limits. But if you're in the Senate, would you ask that those property tax caps be repealed or kept?
Well, I just think in general, it's bad government to take away the close accountability between elected officials and the ability to make decisions for their own community. So for instance, if you're, you know, the Madison Common Council or Dane County or the Madison School District, you should be able to make decisions, and you should also have the authority to pay for those decisions through raising revenue and making taxes. And that way, if the voters don't like what you've done, they can throw you out. But what we have in Wisconsin is, over the decades, a taking away of local control and breaking that important accountability link that's so important to have a functioning democracy. So I think that we should not have state mandated revenue caps, and we should let local governments meet the needs of their communities.
Since local governments rely on the property tax to pay for 40% of their local services, is it time to look at alternative revenue sources, perhaps broadening the 5% state sales tax to now exempt products and services, giving local governments, instead of just counties, the option of levying a half-cent sales tax? Is it time to look for other revenue options for local governments?
Well, I think we certainly do need to think comprehensively about the tax burden that working families are facing in this state. One of the biggest problems with the current tax system we have right now is that there are such limited options for municipalities to raise revenue that a lot of the options they have are not very progressive. If you're just adding a, you know, wheel tax, that, you know, we've certainly tried, I think, in many communities to make it more progressive and offer rebates and things like that. But the bottom line is that it's very, very difficult to make that fair. And so looking at connecting the raising of revenue to how much somebody makes, I think is really important. We want your ability to pay to be reflected in the tax burden that you face.
We have never resolved the debate over a stable funding source for highways. Mm-hmm. Our gas tax, 30.9 cents per gallon, hasn't been increased in 10 years. Is it time to raise that, Kelda?
I think it is. I mean, you know, we have a lot of deferred maintenance. We, under the previous governor, Scott Walker, we had the worst, among the worst roads in the nation, depending on what metric you used. And so we have a lot of infrastructure work and work on the roads that just hasn't been done. And we need to prioritize that maintenance. But we also need to be investing in new transit opportunities for people who don't have access to a car or might not want to own a car or have two cars for a family. So yes, raising the gas tax, I think, is an important part of that, and reindexing it to inflation so that we don't end up with this continued gap in funding for an absolutely essential public infrastructure product.
You've heard the debate over tolling. Your position on that?
I'm not a big fan of toll roads necessarily, but I'm open to the discussion about it. I mean, as a Wisconsin girl, I like the idea of Illinois drivers having to pay to help take care of our roads. I mean, I think that's great. But I think we have to really, again, we need to look at people's ability to pay. We need to make sure that, you know, workers and low-income and economically vulnerable people are not disproportionately hit. And so I'm interested in a long-term transportation strategy that matches progressive values and that meets the needs of everyone in our community, not just the wealthiest.
I want to ask you about a 2015 study that found that out-of-state contractors were awarded $72 million in contracts for public works projects approved by local governments. That $72 million doubled to $146 million in 2018. The question, should bidding standards and requirements give preferences to Wisconsin companies when local governments authorize these public works projects?
Yeah, I think that makes sense. You know, just as consumers are thinking during this economic crisis, how can I help sustain you know, my local restaurants and the, you know, the places I like to shop on main streets. I think we need to be doing that as a state. It makes sense that we should spend our public dollars in ways that help support the economic life and success of our communities.
Well, having gone to your website, I know you've got positions on a number of issues. So I want to give you a chance to talk about an issue that's important to your campaign that we haven't yet touched on, please.
Well, there are a lot of things that I think are really important, but one of the most important to me is public education. You know, Wisconsin used to be known for its wonderful schools and the university system, but over the decades, they have been systematically defunded. I think we need to really reinvest in public education. And I say that as a public school grad myself, somebody who went to UW Law School, but also as the mom and stepmom of four girls. And I want them to have a great future in this state. I want everyone to have the opportunity to succeed. And it really starts with public education, not just K-12, but higher ed and addressing the student loan burden, but also really investing in early childhood education. Everything from paid family and sick leave, even more important during a pandemic, and making sure we have great early childhood education before kindergarten.
Final question, differences between you and your opponents in the August 11 primary, Kelda?
Well, it's great that we've got a crowded primary. That's very healthy for democracy. I think that, you know, my progressive policies are certainly very detailed. I've thought a lot and I've spent my life over the last almost 20 years working to enact progressive change. My experience, not just talking about what I believe, but actually enacting it and passing laws, even when Republicans were in control of the legislature, even when I was not in the state assembly, but as an advocate, I think that really sets me apart from the crowd. That experience is essential, and especially right now as we face these multiple challenges.
Appreciate it. Okay, Kelda Roys of Madison is a Democratic candidate in the 26th State Senate District, excuse me. The primary is August 11. Kelda, thanks for talking to WisconsinEye.
Good to see you, Steve.
Thank you very much.
Campaign 2020 is sponsored by Wisconsin Hospital Association, Quick Trip, Wisconsin Counties Association, Wisconsin Realtors Association, and Wisconsin Operating Engineers Local 139.